Welcome to The Raw Truth, a platform that I created for real estate professionals, loan officers, consumers direct, emphasizing on real estate, obviously, core values, and just giving them information to help them make positive and educated real estate decisions. So welcome to The Raw Truth. And today in studio, I have Andres Hoyos and Hector Escalona, Sync Brokerage, my people. This brokerage blew my mind. We are here in studio. I am now part of Sync Brokerage, which is an honor, and I thank you for that. And as I was thinking about the three of us coming together, I said, wow, we have one key component. We are first generation wealth.
Yep.
So we have it in us to succeed, which is not common in everyone. But when I met both of you, we have the same vision. We have the same goals, the same dreams. And I thank you for being here today.
Super excited to be here.
Tell us a little bit about you. I know you've been in real estate for a while.
Not that much. Well, first of all, it's exciting. It's an honor to be here. I was really looking forward to be part of your podcast. Love the office, the environment. I mean, the whole setup is beautiful. Got in real estate in 2008 by accident. And as you mentioned, it's first generation in real estate. I would say first generation building wealth. Kind of like rewiring ourselves, and the way I'm actually raising my girls is completely different than the way I was brought up. But yeah, I got in real estate in 2008 by accident, totally an accident. And I fell in love with freedom. I fell in love with opportunity. And organically, the more I spend time doing it, I developed the passion for it. And it's been, what, 14, 16 years now?
That's amazing. That's amazing.
It's a journey. I have a lot of passion for it. And my goal is now to pass on those years of experience and help others, you know, achieving their own dreams.
Amazing. And I heard that you are top by volume, right? With NAHRAP amongst the 250?
Top Latino broker nationwide, based on volume, number second, yeah.
That's amazing. And we have Colombia in the house. We have Venezuela in the house.
Naciones Unidas.
How amazing is that? So we have like La Naciones Unidas aquí. Yeah, so we're going to do this kind of Spanglish. Hector, tell us a little bit about you.
Yeah. He honrado. Estoy feliz de estar acá contigo, con Andrés. Realmente estoy muy entusiasmado por el simple hecho de que se están dando y que está fluyendo una energía maravillosa en el mundo del real estate y estamos conspirando positivamente para que las cosas pasen.
Definitivamente.
Conspirando, ¿ah?
Claro, estamos conspirando. El universo, Dios, las energías se juntan y nosotros le damos acción. Yo sí inicié en el real estate por decisión, parte del reinvento, de la necesidad de reinventarse como venezolano, y mi decisión fue allá, el objetivo. ¿Dónde hay un nicho de mercado que puedas explotar, donde puedas generar un valor, donde puedas contribuir? Y ahí estoy. Pienso que el real estate necesita de esto que estamos haciendo, de sinergia, de colaboración, de trabajo en equipo, y como siempre digo, mentalidad de ganador. Cuando tú tienes una mentalidad de ganador, pasan estas cosas. Nos juntamos, nos conocemos y estamos aquí.
Qué bueno, qué bueno. ¿Y tú piensas mudarte para la Florida?
Oh my God. Está en tu plan.
It's a dream and you're going to achieve. I mean, it's there.
I have it on my, it's in my plans. I have a timeline for it. We are already working on the things that we need to, you know, kind of like get set up in LA in order for us to have a smooth transition as the company continues growing as well. We're looking for the lifestyle that you guys have here.
I think that's why Florida, Miami in particular is overpopulated, And we're going to continue to build up. Now we're going to have to start building. People are going to start building their houses up because,
it's just unique.
Yeah.
Vibe, the energy. I was just mentioning to you yesterday, like usually in LA, we don't gather together to, you know, break bread while you're having a normal business day. No, I mean, over there, it's just like back to back. I mean, if you actually have lunch, it's like it was a slow day.
Yeah.
You don't have the time to really connect with people unless you kind of like set the time aside and create an event to connect with people. It's not like here.
I think here in Miami, and correct me if I'm wrong, you do business with the people you have not a personal relationship with, but that you build that friendship. Here, you have to create those relationships, be in people's face all the time. Like, you have to be continuously telling them what you're doing.
Right.
And obviously, I think removing your personal interest and offering that friendship here works a lot. And it'll come back. I don't know if in LA it's a little bit different, where it's more business. Here is like, we find a celebration in everything. I mean,
I can see that.
Yeah, we have lunch every day and we try to balance it.
Something that me costaría a mí acoplarme to the lifestyle, to the culture. That will take me a minute.
It's different in LA.
Yeah, that will take me a minute.
Yeah.
La cultura es más caribeña, más latinos, ¿verdad? Somos más acogedores. And I see that over here, we love to talk a lot and build long-term relationships with conversations that go for a while. Meanwhile, you're also doing business. LA is just dry and cut to the point, short.
Right.
So it's different.
Right. Is there anything you want to know about me now that we're
Absolutely. I mean, I don't know your story. I know just a little bit, whatever I was able to find on Google. but I do know 27 years of experience. Something that I really admire is not just as real estate broker, but also mortgage.
Right.
And you have knowledge and title.
Yes, I do.
I love the fact that, the mindset that you have. Hector estaba hablando de las energías del universo, de que, you know, things fall into place and the right people get, you know, unexpectedly in the right place at the same time. I think esa es la situación que está sucediendo acá. So I love the energy that you have. It's un imán, right? It pulls you.
Right.
Yeah.
The energy, I love the vibe, I love the knowledge, el carisma que tienes. So, but how you got to where you are now?
I think I got into all aspects in real estate because of service. And okay. I think with the newer generation, the sense of urgency is lacking. And the sense of service, for the most part, is lacking. I found myself at a young age knowing that my word was my currency.
Can we skip one second?
Sure.
Like quotations right there.
Uh-huh.
So back then you were like what, 15 to get your license? No.
No. Like why do we have to bring the age into why do we have to bring the age into a queen cut, you know? I started in the business at the age of 19. I literally got my license in July and I turned 19.
Okay.
My birthday is in April and I got my license in July of 1997. So I started there. I made a lot of money at a very young age with very little resources because we didn't have the internet, because I self-taught myself.
Okay.
Trial and error. I said it in one of my previous podcasts that I got kicked out of rental communities all the time. I would go put stop why rent when you can buy with $3,000, and that kicked
Smart.
It off for me. So I, after what I didn't do back then that I do now is stay consistent. You see, I wake up every day now and I feel like I have a Velcro wall, and I just grab you know, balls and throw at the wall, and not everything's gonna stick. Some of those balls will fall down, but every day if you don't wake up and throw at that Velcro wall, I mean, you become in a financial burden. Yeah. And then, so I didn't do that at a young age. That's why my house went into foreclosure. That's why I, you know, encountered all those things, which I think that the generation that's coming in now that does not take advantage of all the tools that they have and stay consistent. I mean, I think about it now and I say, my God, I lost my house back then because I didn't have a side job. No existía. Like, it didn't exist to do Uber Eats, or it didn't exist to be an Uber driver to try to make things happen. So
but
now
you have the opportunity to go and find a part-time job. You decided not to, to stay full-time, consistent, doing what you were doing.
On my dream. Okay. And I did it. And I did it with two girls by myself. So that person that comes in that wants to do this part-time, I mean, yeah, you can have your little, because I know we all have bills, and you could do your Uber on the weekends or whatever, but your main focus has to be on your dream.
Yeah.
So that's where I was all the time. And then the knowledge, the education, the wanting more, the what's next. For me, it was what's next? How can I get there? I didn't have the upbringing of financial stability.
Yep.
So I needed to make it happen. And I already had two girls where I didn't want to give them the same life I lived. I wanted to be able to get them the Nike shoes.
Right.
I didn't have that growing up. I had to go buy like the kids that didn't have the little blue thing in the back.
So know? The way yeah, I see yeah, it, yeah. Eso para nosotros es, I value this struggle a lot. In business, como empresarios, I have learned how to love pain just the same way I love everything else that comes easier. Mm-hmm. Porque es lo que te da a ti como que ese, it empowers you to define your character. When you have that hunger within you, that gives you the drive. It's like survival, right? That is the one thing that I'm afraid as a dad, that my girls won't grow up with that hunger. Because it's a lot easier.
It's a lot easier for them.
And I don't know, I just value that hunger.
Yeah.
Tengo dos preguntas para ti.
Dígame.
Tienes una historia increíble, poderosa, son 27 años, ¿no? Mm-hmm. ¿Cuál ha sido el reto, el desafío más grande que ha tenido en la industria?
El desafío más grande fue cuando en el 2009, 2010, cuando todo el mundo perdió la casa, los valores bajaron, no supe manejar entre todos los problemas que uno tenía personalmente, un exiting strategy. No tenía un exiting strategy. En ese momento yo tenía 8 propiedades, cuales todas bajaron de valor, que hoy en día si yo hubiese sabido cómo manejarme o hubiese pensado un poquito más allá, o estuviéramos más que millonaria hoy, porque el valor de esas casas que bajaron tanto, hoy están en el doble. So, fue inexperiencia y edad.
Y edad.
Creo que ahora con esta madura edad que tengo, uno piensa las cosas mejor y uno analiza cuál es la ruta a tomar que nos ayuda. Pero sí, el 2010 fue para mí, it was bad, pero lo pasamos. Me quedé en real estate, en la parte de finanzas, porque me fui a trabajar para un banco, uh-huh. Cual duré 10 meses porque es corporate world. Y después de 10 meses yo dije, ¿tú sabes qué hago aquí?
Claro.
Si yo sé hacer dinero, let me get out of here. And then I started this again.
¿Qué le dirías a un agente de hoy en día? Si lo tuviese, ¿cuál sería ese mayor consejo que le darías a un agente?
Que se conecte, que se rodee de personas positivas, personas que lo van a elevar. Yo creo que cuando yo lo hice no tenía eso, y hoy hay Sync Brokerage que se pueden venir a la compañía, y de verdad que la mentoría del sistema me capturó, y yo creo que la gente nueva, si quiere ser successful en real estate, definitivamente lo tienen todo en la palma de las manos, solo tienen que tener el querer.
Claro, claro. ¿Cómo ves Miami? ¿Cómo ves la industria de Miami? Vamos a preguntarle a Andrés, sí, porque viene el
I have no filter.
Ya.
Yeah. You okay with that?
Yeah. I am. Hay okay que decir las cosas que this no se dicen.
Mira, esto es la cruda verdad.
Esto es la cruda verdad. ¿Cómo ves Miami?
Miami.
Vamos a ponerle sazón a esto.
Número uno, Miami es una ciudad hermosa. Tiene mucha diversidad. Tiene mucha gente bella. Hay muchísima oportunidad. Bastante dinero. Hay team de que Miami en este momento. Actually, cuando yo traje Sync a Miami en el 2021, I used to tell the agents, Miami has a run of 3 to 5 years. Estamos en el 2024, 3 years later, I can still say Miami has another run of at least 5 to 10 years now. Tiene muchísima oportunidad, hay bastante dinero, hay mucho potencial que todavía no se ha explotado en Miami. Creo que viene con la cultura de que a medida de que en general, no solamente real estate, pero en general la comunidad de Miami cambie su mindset, improve the work ethic, y reconozcan de que están viviendo en the land of opportunities y al mismo tiempo you can, you know, you're living in the place where people come for vacation, like, yeah. I call it el paraíso, ¿no? Están viviendo en el paraíso, tienen las dos cosas, yeah. En el momento que la gente en realidad aprenda a reconocer esa oportunidad, Miami va a explotar, honestamente, que to me that's gonna be the new New York, LA. You have it all, man.
I don't know why, but I love to travel and I love to explore new things. But when I get to Miami International Airport and I'm back in Miami, like, I am home. I am so glad that I am home.
It's a beautiful airport. Honestly, just the amount of opportunity. You know, bringing a company from LA to a new culture, a new state, new regulations, and the whole thing. I mean, just the culture itself, it's not easy. I can tell you the first 2 years for us were pretty difficult. Most brokers will be like, you know what, F this, I'm going back to, you know, my market and expand there. But I know there is an opportunity here. Y al traer todo lo que hemos creado de LA, los sistemas, la cultura, el support, a little bit of the work ethic, and if you really take the time to coach people the right way in business, like you really care. It's not just an agent, but hey, let me help you change your life the way someone helped me. You can, one agent at a time, you can change the industry and you can change a lot of lives because that person is going to be a father, a mother, and therefore all of those blessings move on, you know, to future generations. So
right.
The purpose is big.
The purpose is huge. And I honestly have a vision and I already saw it in multiple states.
Wow.
I promise that we're gonna be in multiple states. And I was told, why do you care what people do? You know, why do you care so much? What is it in for you? And I think that what I take when I help someone is more internal for me and something that the day I die, I'm gonna take with me, because you can't take money with you. You can't take properties, cars, you can't take nothing.
Nope.
But that feeling of me changing someone's life, I can take with me. So I think that that's common for the three of us. And because people will tell me, you know, like the haters will say, why are you coaching or why do you care? And it's a selfish feeling, I think, because I'm taking it with me. I'm not gonna.
It could be selfish and it's not selfish porque lo estás compartiendo con todo el mundo. So. It is selfish because that's fulfilling you. Es lo que te completa, ¿no? Right. Te hace sentir, you know, 100%. So, question. I saw one of your videos in social media que decía, fuiste parte de compañías grandes en real estate, right? Que fue otro punto de conexión que vi. Actually, just yesterday I saw it. Fuiste parte de compañías grandes de real estate. Trabajaste para un banco. A real estate agent puede hacer mucho dinero as an independent agent, right? Mm-hmm. No responsibilities, no liabilities. But why choosing to go independently and opening your own business? Mm. Running your own mortgage company, real estate company. Why?
Because of the service. Because I know when I tell someone you're closing tomorrow, you best believe unless the earth disappears, you're closing tomorrow. Like my word.
What about the things that are without, like the things that are not in your control and impacts your performance?
The thing is that that's why I decided to educate myself on the three things. I do have control. I have the control because for lending, I lend off of my warehousing lines. I'm the one that's gonna fund your deal for the most part. So I am in control. When I tell my client, when I sit with a client at the beginning, I give him the expectations, whether it's real estate or financing, what could happen and what's the best route. And when I say it's approved, it has to be that the person lost their job, something happened, you know, on their financial part. I had a client that we were set for closing and the poor girl had her money with her partner and ready to close at the closing table, and the wire wouldn't come in and the wire wouldn't come in. I found out later on the guy gambled it in the Megazuki. So it has to be something like out of my control. Okay. So expectations for me are everything, you know, and I know my weaknesses and I know my virtues. Yeah. And I think if everyone sits down and really digs deep as to what are those in your life and you don't run from your negatives and understand them, I think you're going to succeed.
Okay, servicio.
¿Cuál es la cruda verdad para una mujer de negocios en esta nueva era?
La cruda verdad es, primero que nada, ser muy profesional. No desviarte en cosas que te puedan perjudicar, porque las personas son muy malas, y especialmente en una mujer te apuntan el dedo. Mantenerte firme en tus morales, más que nada, y no dejar que la bulla te destruya donde tú quieres ir, porque hay bastante bulla en personas que te miran, que te envidian, que te quieren derrotar porque estás brillando. Si tú puedes mirar por encima de todo eso, una mujer debe de poder succeed.
Me encanta porque ella, mira, tiene muchas virtudes como empresaria, pero también sabemos que estás en el mundo del crecimiento espiritual.
Sí.
Has hecho unos viajes interesantes por allí.
O esa parte yo no la sabía.
Sí. Has hecho unos viajes poderosos.
No me han hecho full disclosure.
Ah, sí.
¿Qué te llevó a eso? ¿Cuál fue ese punto de quiebre? ¿Por qué entraste en este?
El quién soy.
¿Quién es Iris?
¿Quién es Iris? El quién soy para mí, no quién yo quiero proyectar a las personas.
Wow.
Auténtico. Hablando de autenticidad.
Sí. Yeah. So, eso, estuve en una relación en diciembre que la terminé porque no podía avanzar. Y en ese momento tuve que ver quién es Iris, qué es lo que quiere Iris para Iris, no para las personas. Y creo que eso, junto con el querer positivo para las personas, es un complemento a donde yo quiero ir, en realidad.
Súper poderoso, súper poderoso.
Funny que mencionas, pero I'm very spiritual. Te dije la vez pasada, I'm huge in energy, like I can sense people's energy, even without talking to them. Like if I feel like negatividad, I push back.
Yeah.
También es muy espiritual.
Sí.
Energía
sí.
También. So there is a connection here.
Todos tenemos.
Which is, it's amazing.
Sí, parece curioso, ¿no? Pero todos en sync tenemos algo que nos identifica y esa energía, esa manera de canalizar todo lo que hemos transcurrido como seres humanos, porque para poder ser grandes empresarios, para poder tener una posición de liderazgo en una industria, tienes que ser antes un ser humano, un ser para poder hacer. Y realmente lo que estamos viendo, porque Iris tiene muchas cositas ahí que no sé si lo quieres sacar ahorita públicamente, pero tienes una historia de vida muy interesante. Ella pasó por un tema de salud bastante complicado, sí, en un momento de su vida que creo que te llevó a poner orden, ¿no?, en el mundo, sí, de los negocios.
Quise abarcar y quedar bien con tanto.
Okay.
Que mi salud se deterioró. Tuve un transient ischemic attack, un TIA.
Oh, wow.
Y gracias a Dios pude sobrevivirlo. Tú sabes, estoy aquí hoy.
So your journey hasn't been easy.
No, at all. Everyone
sees. Looking like even like 2008. Yeah.
No, everyone sees rainbows and Skittles. And Iris is having an amazing life, but no one knows what it is to fill these shoes. And not only as a woman, but as the head of my household. Yeah. And helping my mom. I come from not wealth. I wasn't given that silver spoon. So yeah, I mean, everyone sees it now, but no one sees the tears that came with this whole thing.
So I'm so glad that you mentioned that. Porque digamos la nueva generación de real estate agents nowadays, the minute they lose their first transaction or their first prospect, or maybe they start prospecting or whatever it is, they spend whatever, 6 months in business and they haven't closed anything, they give up, right? Because the perception of whatever they see on Netflix, online, social media, I think that a lot of people are becoming real estate agents because of that. Right?
It's
the inspiration.
Right.
But the minute they see, oh, wow, this is hard. But they don't really know what's hard. They don't really know what it actually takes to go through that journey and get to the other side.
Yeah. Yo creo que esa es la cruda realidad. Los agentes hoy en día en promedio están pensando que ser real estate o ser un mortgage broker o sacar la licencia de algo te vas a hacer millonario. Te vas a tener ya tu propia empresa. Y creo que lo conversábamos ayer. A lo mejor abrir una empresa es fácil en papeles, pero mantener la consistencia, mantener el trabajo en equipo, yo creo que ese es un reto bastante interesante que tú nos has demostrado que has superado.
Te tiene que gustar el dolor, en esa, tienes que ser masoquista.
No, y se frustran. ¿Eh? Hay una generación que se frustra fácilmente.
Yeah, I think you have to know how to ride the wave. Because real estate, now it's been very consistent, and I think, I want to say, real estate is gonna continue to, at least in Miami, because I think there's gonna be some changes in Miami in the near future that is just gonna boom Miami.
Which, that happened already.
No, you know what, it hasn't happened. I did say it in one of my videos. I believe that Wall Street is going to shut down in New York and it's going to open up in Brickell City Center. I've said it for a while. Now you actually Google it and it does come out that we are considered Wall Street South. So even if you Google it, it'll come out. So I think the bigger change has not happened yet. And when that does, living in Miami at least is going to be a luxury.
It already is. Yeah. I mean, I'm looking at prices right now in Miami. There,
it's luxury.
It's luxury.
It's just like LA, and even more expensive than LA.
Right.
Wow. I've been looking, and it's like, I mean, honestly, people moving to Miami. One, you need to have a good income, a good career. Otherwise, stuck, carísimo.
Yeah.
So, what can you tell? I mean, ya preguntaste eso, right? Let's talk about the market now. Let's talk about the market.
Okay.
Your mortgage, you do real estate, you went through the crash, you lost real estate, you learned from that, you went into banking. A lot of realtors right now, they're freaking out because the rates are just over 7%.
Right.
What else is happening? The market pulled back in the last 24 months, but people are freaking out. Agents are like, oh my God, this is not for me.
Yeah.
Is it really a tough market now?
It's a tough market if you don't work it. By that I mean is you need to work on the listings. You need to nurture your buyers.
Okay.
You need to educate yourself with financial, because I've been saying it all along. The realtor that doesn't know the minimum of how to qualify a client, it's just gonna set you below
average.
So is the market tough? Rates are high.
You think so?
They're not high. People are saying they're high because they're comparing the rates to COVID. right? Yeah. Okay. Which was a pandemic, and that's never going to happen again. I don't think race, I mean, we have to be in a world war for that to happen, I think, again. So the minute the rates drop, maybe by 0.75 or 1%, the prices are going to go up. So if I was a buyer right now and I didn't own a house, especially in Florida with the hometown heroes right now, there's so much opportunity. And they're afraid of that interest rate. Wait until the rates drop. The prices are going to go up. So I'd rather date the mortgage versus, you know, buying an expensive house.
Right. So when I started in real estate was when the market crashed in 2008. So imagine trying to sell a house when everybody was losing their homes. I started actually in a difficult market. I started with REOs and short sales and all, you know, the default industry, where one transaction could take up to 6 months before you get paid. Nowadays, the average is 30, 45 right. days, and then you get your commission. Back then, it was 3 to 6 months, easy. Kind of like the streamlined short sales, right? Mm. Most people were upside down con el valor negativo. Mm-hmm. The mortgage was higher than the value of the property.
So you did a lot of short sales.
Oh my God, I was...
You see, that was my downfall.
I was like killing it with short sales. Hablando de que cuando descubres tu gift and your skills, I'm really good on the phone. So empecé a hacer prospecting in the morning from 8:30 to 11:30 and then from 5 to 8 o'clock. Prospecting short sales, notice of default. I got up to 30 listings, short sales. I hired people and I built a short sale department, which eventually became a company, an independent company. I got 5 buyer's agents doing open houses and selling the properties. All of the buyer leads, ellos los trabajaban. I only focus on listings. And that's kind of like how I build my own infrastructure for, you know, as an agent. But nowadays, I mean, those days were difficult. Nowadays, honestly, I don't see the market to be difficult. I think that a 7%, when you look at a, you know, go get a car right now. Your auto loan is like, you know, anywhere between 7% to 22%. Some people pay 30%.
Right.
A credit card, same thing, from 11 to 22%. Now you're talking about a mortgage that is at the very minimum, let's say 300,000, half a million, 30 year term, and the bank is only charging 7% for that amount of money. Yeah. I think it's anywhere between 6.5 and 7.5, that should be the rate.
Which, by the way, when I started in this business, that I started doing mortgages, the rates were 7.5, 8. And we were fine with it. The problem is that the pandemic happened. Everyone wanted the 2.5, 3s. And that's the mentality we're stuck in.
People got spoiled.
But I honestly don't think a 6.5, a 7% is higher. And then I get the people saying, yeah, but the prices are higher. Yeah, we are evolutionizing. we cannot say
it's
that.
It's pretty tough.
Yeah, it's tough, but we're evolutionizing. There's more job opportunity out there. So every time I hear someone saying, no, but the prices are high, I'm like, yeah.
Pero está creando algo de dificultad para, digamos, your average family que trabajan y, let's say, husband and wife make combined, I don't know, 80, 120. Está creando un problema de affordability. Hmm. Prices are going up, rates are high. Then you have property taxes, insurance.
Yeah.
Sometimes you have HOAs.
Yeah.
I mean, no califican. The main problem we're having now is that not everyone can qualify.
Right. Now I have 3 and 4 borrowers on a loan.
Oh, wow. Okay.
Three and four borrowers. And people that want to stay in Miami that are buying these houses, they're all coming together and buying bigger houses. And then there's 2 families living in that bigger house. I mean, I see that every day.
So,
¿cuál es tu visión cuál es tu visión del real estate, o sea, del mercado del real estate internacional para los próximos meses antes del fin del año?
El mercado internacional, I think that you mean people buying here from
South America,
South America.
South America.
Yeah. I think that if they're not doing it, they need to jump on the train. Yeah. Si la persona que es extranjero no ha comprado con tantas oportunidades que hay con los programas como el DSCR, que no tenemos que mostrar ingresos ninguno, que es basado en la rentabilidad de la propiedad. Si el extranjero no está tomando eso como
una oportunidad, una oportunidad,
están fallando, o sea, they're missing out because United States is United States.
Yeah.
And Miami is Miami.
Yeah.
You know, y hay tantos proyectos aquí en Miami, you know, que dan incentivos, que pueden hacer una inversión a largo plazo, porque muchos de ellos no se terminan en 8 meses, 1 año, 2 años. Y como saben, estos proyectos nuevos suben en plusvalía. O sea, hay fases de estos proyectos. So, definitivamente, el inversionista extranjero debe... sí, debería.
¿Tú sigues viendo gente de LA moviéndose para Miami?
Absolutamente. A lot of our investors.
And New Jersey, New yeah. York.
O sea, ¿crees que ese boom va a seguir?
Well, here's the thing. In LA, the economy is pretty healthy. Hacer dinero en LA es muy bueno, ¿ya? The way I see it is, you make the money in LA, you take it out from California and you invest it somewhere else. Miami is super attractivo. You guys don't have rent control. You guys have a lot of benefits for business owners, a lot of benefits when you come in, you know, buy multifamily. Your cap rates are amazing. Values continue going up. If a tenant doesn't pay rent, you can get rid of the tenant in 30 days, easy. Over there, you're stuck with them and they're protected. So, es muy atractivo, y en Los Ángeles hay mucho inversionista, hedge funds, I mean, yeah. You name it, from the small investor to the big investors selling in California, relocating their money to Texas or Florida. So, I mean, we send a lot of business from there.
Yeah.
Hay que tener en cuenta.
Hailing is working with one of them right now. Yeah, so. Yeah, yeah.